Good morning, friends. Good morning. Welcome to David's United Church of Christ. We are so grateful that you are with us, and we're grateful for those of you who are in the room and those of you who are viewing online. We want to welcome you to this congregation, which strives always to bear witness to the fact that all of us are made in God's image. All of us are welcome. We are all God's children together. So we have a few announcements before the service begins. I want to thank everyone who helped out yesterday for the funeral, for the Lois Bosshart funeral. Lois's family gathered from around the world, family traveling in from Ireland and LA and around the area, and they were pleased to be so well served as we remember together with Thanksgiving a longtime member of this congregation, Lois Bosshart. We do have a couple of other changes and things you should be aware about. Next Saturday, I've been asked to do a graveside funeral at 10 a.m. So we're going to push the anti-racism viewing of our next episode of the 1619 Project to 11 a.m. So those of you that attend that group, you get an extra hour sleep on Saturday. I don't think we'll have too many complaints about that. But there is a need for the Rob Castile family to have a graveside funeral that morning at 10 a.m. We also have Dragons tickets on sale. I believe Saturday, there he is. A man who knows his job.
These are first July 22nd, 7 p.m. David's Church has a lot of seats in section 115. If you want to come up for me, you can have a check at David's Church. I'll be in the lobby after the service. Otherwise, they're available in the office from Kathy or Gwen. They're in the office.
So that's two Saturdays from yesterday. Yes, all right. So in 2 weeks. Also, some of you may be interested in issue one. I know a lot of faith communities have spoken out on the issue. The League of Women Voters, as you know, which is nonpartisan and likes to just present the facts and let people make up their own mind, which is our preference here in this congregation as well, has put together a little bit of a news flyer. I've made about 25 or 50 of those, I didn't count, but they'll stack about that high, out there in the on the table in the narthex. These are, if you vote yes or if you vote no, what the meaning of that is. Many faith communities have made a strong statement about it. You can learn more about that on your own. And then I want to remind folk who are interested in membership in our church, next Sunday we will be taking in new members. If you've not met with me and you would like to become a new member of our congregation, give me a call early this week and we'll get you the paperwork and walk through any questions or concerns you may have. And I believe I got through all of the announcements. Hooray. Now, let us turn our hearts and minds to what matters here this morning, the worship of the living God. All who are comfortably able are invited to rise as we sing, "Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing," number 400.
Thank you. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
Please join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. We have been called here to face into God's gracious way of living. We are free to leave the past behind us and walk into these new days of our ministry. But this is a new day, and Christ is sharing freedom with us. It is a day to put aside all fear, to leave doubting behind, and to take courage in God's loving call. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, Jesus told us he was the way, the truth, and the life. He said, follow me. Follow me and live the way I showed you. Follow me and live the truth I showed you. Follow me and live the life I showed you. The way, the truth, the life he showed us was your love. Live the way of love. Live the truth of love. Live the life of love. I heard a woman say, all we have to do is love Jesus and love one another. Yes, all we have to do. Living in love is a complicated, painstaking, patient path. And all the time, every time, watch where you're going path. Living love means making decisions all day long to love. Living love means patience with those who don't care about living love. Living love means watching our words as well as our actions, and living love means treating others as we ourselves want to be treated. Living love means forgiving, means forgetting, and means there is no room for self-righteousness. It means being together, the people of God, a community of those who love one another and who love all the one another's that you created. Living love means going into all the world and telling your story. Jesus said, God is love. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. If we have the eyes to see and the ears to hear, your abundant love will be ours. May we feel your love as we gather today. Amen. Please pass the peace of Christ to your neighbor.
Good morning. If I could invite the children to join me up here. Awesome. Thank you for the lovely music. It is so good to be back. I've been gone for like 3 weeks. So I want to talk to you about, do you remember the story in the Bible where Jesus had a yard sale? How about where he had a lemonade stand? Okay, I grew up in a much more fundamental church, and that's what they told us. So they must have been using a different version. But the reason that I'm bringing that up is this week we're having, well, we're getting prepared for a rummage sale. Do you know what that is? What is that? You went to it last year? What do you do when you rummage through something?
Yeah, you look for treasures, right? So I looked up Romans because I didn't know what it meant either. Yes, Lila. Oh, you know what? You're stealing my words. She said it's kind of a saying someone's trash, someone's treasure. That's absolutely right. Yeah. So to rummage, according to the dictionary, is to search thoroughly or actively through, especially by moving around, turning over, or looking through contents. Does anybody have a messy room? Do your parents ever rummage through your room and think, what is this mess? What's going on? Okay. Well, we'll let you know if we can visit so you can clean it all up. But Lila took my words because this rummage sale, people go through, they go through the house, they get rid of all the stuff that they don't want, that they might be trash. Sometimes it's really nice stuff. But then other people come in, and for really discounted prices, they get treasures. What does that have to do with the children's movement? I don't know either. No, just, yeah, Lila. No! If the parents slip me somewhere, and I tell them to clean their rooms. What I want you to know is sometimes we have really good days as people, and sometimes we have really kind of challenging days, right? Sometimes we feel like the treasure, or there's a you'll learn this greater later, sometimes you're the bug, and sometimes you're the windshield. You know what I'm talking about? But what my point this, and I will wrap it up, I promise. My point with this is the treasures. Jesus and God made you guys, and you are treasures. Sometimes we don't always feel like that, but I promise you that you are a treasure to Jesus, to your family, and to our own church members. We love and we value each and every one of you, and you're an important part of our church now and our future. So if anybody ever tries to make you feel less than a treasure, you remember that you are a gold star in our crown here at David's, okay? And if you want to help with the rummage sale and you want to clean your rooms, I'm sure your parents would love that too, okay? But that's not going to work? Okay, sorry. I tried, Mom. So let's say a quick prayer. Dear Lord, I just thank you for this church family, and I thank you for these beautiful faces that we see both in the pews and up here in children's moment. I thank you for everything that you have given us and the treasures that you provide us individually, but also the treasures that we become for others. And I just pray that you will wrap us in your safety and continue to bring us back each week. In thy name we pray, amen.
I remember going to my first rummage sale and be really disappointed. There was not one glass of rum. And I looked. We are moving into that season, so for the next couple of weeks, our church will be kind of transformed. Please be patient. If you have a dust allergy, make sure you double up on your meds before you come. I think about that every year because it gets a little much. But we are so grateful for all of your contributions. And I know that there's plenty of work to go around. So if you'd like to contribute your energy, time, and abilities, I know if you talk to Debbie McCoy or other members of the rummage team, they would be glad to get your assistance and help. As you know, many of you, if you've been paying attention at all to my Facebook and to things we've shared on our church page, this last week was the 34th Synod of the United Church of Christ. And this gathering of our national church is always a bit of a festival as well as a business meeting and a gathering of celebration of the identity in the United Church of Christ. A while back, our church took on this mission statement. It's something you can say very quickly and easily. In God's love, a just world for all. Because we believe in God's love for the whole world, we believe that God calls us to make the world, to work in the world for justice for all our sisters and brothers, wherever they may be, whether they be global or local. We are concerned about their best interest and the interests of our world. And so many of the resolutions that came before the, the 34th Synod were political in nature. They were certainly about justice. They were certainly about trying to make our world over again in the image of God's kingdom, God's kingdom, God's community of faith. And so I won't belittle this by going on and on about each one, but I think it's important to hear some of them because our congregations who bring forward these resolutions are really concerned about citizens and people in our lives that are struggling, suffering in challenging places. For instance, one resolution that passed very strongly was for harm reduction to deal with the overdose crisis in our nation, and especially here in the Midwest, to work to help folk who are addicted to drugs to get the care they need to help them prolong their lives so that they may eventually choose sobriety and security, safety, and new life. As we dealt with the ecological challenges to our planet, we each year, each day, we seem to be breaking heat records on this planet, and we know that that creates danger down the road for future generations, as well as those of us alive today with flooding and fires and all of the challenges our ecology, our environment are facing. And so there was a resolution for congregations and individual Christians in our community to try to free themselves from plastic pollution. We know that the problem with plastic is that it takes 1,000 years to break down, which means that our landfills are full of things that are not going to return to soil, return to the earth, break down, and make the world more usable. They're just going to fill up the space. And one person pointed out that there's enough water in our oceans now, that there's water now in all of us. I mean, excuse me, plastic now in all of us, that there are small particles of plastic in all of our water, in our food, in our land. And so we need to, as a community, as a nation, as individuals, to try to restrict our contribution of more plastic into this world of ours. There were issues also about public education, supporting educators and teachers against the idea of banning books and depleting the history departments from the ability to teach all of the history. There was a resolution about condemning solitary confinement in our prison system, which solitary confinement is described by the United Nations Human Rights Group as torture. And so eliminating this practice creates an environment where we can actually think about our prisoners, those who are in prison for committing crimes, rehabilitating rather than becoming more mentally and personally unstable. We affirm the dignity, the human dignity of folk dealing with trans and non-binary issues in their personal life, a condemnation of white supremacy. They suggested that our churches should be white supremacist free zones, and I'm in favor of that. We affirmed the right to break down our guns and to deal with gun violence by preventing gun violence by converting guns to gardens. There's a program that actually takes guns away, melts them down, and makes them into usable garden tools. That was a work on Isaiah, which says your spears and your swords will be turned into pruning hooks and spades for farming. And finally, there was a denouncing of two Supreme Court decisions. One, the Dobbs decision. Our Synod voted to affirm that abortion is health care, and we opposed the destruction, essentially the end of affirmative action, because affirmative action is just one tool toward racial equity based on our years of history in our world. I share all these with you not because I want to over-politicize our worship, but to help you realize that the just world for all part of our call to be the body of Christ really takes into consideration the brokenness of our world, the individuals and people in our world who are struggling, and a desire to see the world made whole, healed, and made at peace. It's a challenging set of resolutions, but if we take them seriously, if we bring them into our own lives, if we reflect on them and begin to act in the world more faithfully, more graciously, more kindly, more justly, perhaps we could see a new world for all created, even in our own time and midst. The United Church of Christ, and here at David's United Church of Christ, everything that we do, our ministry together, all of that is made possible by your time, your energy, your creativity, and your gifts. We are so grateful for the way this congregation supports its own ministry in the community and in the world. And we invite you to give freely and joyfully. If you're online, of course, you can go to our safe giving portal on our webpage. And here in our sanctuary, we will now collect the offering. Let us give to God freely and joyfully so that God's kingdom may be born among us more faithfully and more truthfully as we live forward. Gracious and good God, you have blessed our lives with so much plenty, so much joy in the world that we have experienced, joy enough to carry us through the challenging days when they come and to bring us to the other side with your love and grace. Take and use these gifts, we pray, that the gospel of your love for the world and for all the people in it might be shared in this community and throughout the world. We pray that you would take and use our gifts, use our lives, use our contributions, that the good news of your love might be spread all the farther. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. and amen.
Please be seated. Our canticle this morning in our bulletin is adapted from the message from Psalm 86, verses 1 through 10. God is all mercy and grace, not quick to anger, but rich in love. Creation and all the creatures applaud you. God, your holy people bless you. Letting the world know of God's power for good, the lavish splendor of God's kingdom.
Your kingdom is eternal. You'll never get voted out of office.
God always does what God says, and is gracious in everything God does.
God gives a hand to those down on their luck. He gives a fresh start to those ready to quit.
Everything God does is right. The trademark on all God's works is love.
God's care, listening for all who pray, for all who pray and mean it.
God does what's best for those who are in awe of God.
God hears them call out, and God saves them.
Friends, when we get to our epistle reading later in the service, we will hear the words of Paul, who said that he does the very things he hates. I'm sure that doesn't happen to any of us, where we do the exact opposite of the thing we want to do, say the thing we hope we wouldn't say, act in ways we hope we wouldn't act. But of course, we're all vulnerable to that very experience, because our human will doesn't always match our desire to be the best possible version of ourselves. And so the confession comes to us as a gift, an opportunity to name those things in our lives that haven't worked out the way we had hoped, and to receive the good news of God's grace and forgiveness so that we can begin again and become the people we desire to be, the people God has called us to be, that God has made us to be. So let's acknowledge that we, like Paul, sometimes say and do the opposite of what we would hope to do and say. Most holy and merciful God, in your presence, we must face the sinfulness of our lives, the errors of our ways, intended or accidental. You alone know how often we have failed by wandering your paths, wasting your gifts, fleeing the call of your love. Have mercy upon us, O God, for we have broken your requirements for justice and overlooked opportunities for kindness. Humble us with your truth and raise us by your grace, that we may more nearly be the people of Christ and the witnesses of your Spirit. Amen. I'm always touched by the Gospels, in which Jesus again and again shows patience and kindness and love to his disciples, even when he tells them one thing and they do the opposite, even when he hopes that they'll do the thing he desires most and then finds them falling short. He doesn't turn his back on them. In fact, even on the night of his betrayal and desertion, Jesus breaks bread, drinks the cup, and says to the group of his disciples, who he probably realizes are going to abandon him shortly, that they are his friends and they are his beloved. I take comfort in that this day, to know that even as we walk with God and stumble along the path, God is gracious and kind with those who are following after Jesus. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, God of the thunderstorm, God of the sun and the clouds, the rain, and all that is in the world, we come before you this morning grateful for your love, not always completely understanding it, not always able to grasp the fullness of it, the unconditionalness of it, the caring kindness of it, but we hold fast to that love nonetheless. We are awed that you love us when we do not love either ourselves or each other as we might. That you love us not only in our pain, not only in our rejoicing, but even in our bumbling confusion, which comes more often than we would like to admit. As a father's kiss heals a wounded knee, or a mother's song heals a frightened heart, so your love reaches through us and heals. It is for your healing that we gather this day. We come before you and pray for the healing of all that is broken, both in our lives, in our relationships, and in the world that you have made. We ask that your healing love come into the world which is in great need. We pray that it reach the victims of floods or terrorism or gun violence, just like our neighbors and friends in Cleveland last night. And we think of all the victims of loneliness and pain who are struggling this day for any number of reasons, and we pray, O God, your healing be near to them. We pray that your love touch people in all the corners of the earth. We pray, O gracious God, for people whose names we do not know, but whose lives we know are precious to you. And for future generations, O gracious God, we pray that you would work within us to bring healing to this earth. We pray for the healing of the environment so that future generations may live safely and walk comfortably upon this gift that you have given to us in the creation of this amazing planet. We pray for those whose names and lives we know well. We think of the parents and children, spouses and friends that are in our lives and in our world and in our hearts. Fill them with your love, we pray. We pray, O gracious God, for those who are struggling this day. We think especially this morning of Kurt, our friend who had a stroke a few weeks back and is struggling. We pray for Gail, who's hospitalized. We pray for Darlene, who's still recovering from knee surgery. We're grateful to hear the good news that she's doing so well with her therapy. And we pray for Phyllis, who was hospitalized with some challenges to her well-being. We pray for her continued health and healing. Even as we pray for those who've been dealing with challenges of health, struggling with challenges of recuperation after surgery, healing and recovery. We pray for Sine, for Andy, for Linda and Richard. We pray for Margie. We pray for Lynn and Larry. We pray for Sarah and Paul. We pray for Heather and Robin, who anticipate surgery in 2 weeks. And we pray for Paul and Jenny. We do pray for the Castile family and their grief. And yesterday, as we celebrated with the Bosshart family, we do pray for those who knew and loved Lois so well and deeply. There are so many of us, O God, who are carrying grief over some loss, some memory, some pain. I've looked back on my memories and realized that it was about 4 years ago that I lost my dad. So many of us, O gracious God, are carrying sadness and sorrow and grief as these anniversaries come round. We pray for the healing of our hearts and that we might be renewed in thanksgiving for the lives and the relationships that have sustained us. We pray for our friends in nursing home and assisted living care. We think of Corinne and Sue. We think of Dave and Thelma, Tom and Mary Lou, Mary Ellen, Bob and Elsie. And there are again so many others, gracious God. While I am celebrating the birth of my first granddaughter, I do pray for baby Olivia, born with Downs and the challenges that come there, still in the NICU and still needing care and healing as she is restored so that she can go home to my daughter and her husband. We just pray for Olivia, for her healing and health and well-being. There are so many other prayers that we have, O gracious God, for our loved ones and friends and family. Hear us now in this moment of silence as each of us lift our concerns, our burdens, our worries and fears, and place them upon your shoulders, knowing your great love and care extends beyond us to those that we love. Finally, O God, we do pray for ourselves and ask for your forgiveness and our inability to live fully in your loving acceptance. Help us not to live as a people of fear. Grant us the courage to believe in your grace and to live into the new ways that you present to us. We pray this in the Spirit of Jesus, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is your kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. That was beautiful. Our first scripture reading today is from the letter of Paul to the Romans. It is chapter 7, verses 15 through 25. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Our second reading this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, selected verses from chapter 11. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. May God bless the reading of the holy words. Amen.
And I do thank you as well, Lisa. I'm in awe of any instrument that has more than six strings. I can barely keep a guitar tuned. So most of you realize I've been on the road for a little while. We've been driving around. We drove up to Michigan for John's wedding and drove back. And we drove by this one billboard. I often wonder if I was a Christian church and I wanted to put on a billboard one thing that spoke of my faith, what would I put? And usually I can name about 10 things I wouldn't put. Because I have seen some crazy billboards. And the one that bothered me most on this trip said, are you preparing to meet Jesus? And I thought, we have to prepare? Because in the Gospels, Jesus shows an amazing openness to meet everyone that he meets in every condition he finds them and be in relationship with them, to open his life to them, to hear their story, to bring healing and wholeness to those who need it, to feed those who are hungry. And here in our text this morning, he's even described as the friend of sinners, tax collectors and sinners. He eats and drinks with them so often that people call him, and I'm going to go right back to the King James, a glutton and a wine bibber. So often is Jesus eating with these people who have been described by their peers as unclean and unworthy. So often as he sat at table with them. By the way, that's the very practice of making someone worthy. When you sit at table with someone and befriend them, you're basically saying, we're all in this together. And Jesus sits with these folk who have been demeaned and left on the margins, these folk who are outsiders, who are described as sinners, tax collectors, unworthy, unwelcome. And Jesus doesn't treat them that way at all. He eats with them so often, he gets a reputation for that. And he chides the people at the beginning. He says, what shall I say of this generation? We played good dance music and you sat numb and still. We invited you to party and you sat like lumps on a log. Sound like Protestants to me, but that's just. And then we played the blues. We sang of our grief and sorrow, and you didn't even join in and own the pain that we all share. By choosing this middle road that seems to be emotionless or emotion-free, Jesus says, you've missed out on your humanity. Children get it. You play a sad song and children will start crying. They understand. There's sadness in the world, and they can relate to that, and they comfort one another on their good days. And when there's a cake, there's Christmas, it's birthday, it's a party. They know how to join in and to celebrate one another's victories and accomplishments and joys. Children get it, but as we get older and we get more sophisticated, we kind of pull ourselves back, we cut ourselves off, we begin to hide our full humanity. And Jesus is repeatedly said again and again, I have come that you may have life and have it in abundance. And so when Jesus sees these weary people, these adults who don't know how to celebrate and enjoy God's love and don't know how to acknowledge with grief and sadness the pain in our world, he sees them missing the point altogether, which is about that billboard I saw. Because I know what that language leads to. Have you prepared to meet Jesus? As if Jesus is going to give us all a test, right? True or false? I was hoping for multiple choice. Maybe an essay where you could BS a little and you know, say a bunch of stuff that kind of impresses people with your vocabulary and intelligence, even though you know you're not saying anything. That whole language is based on a couple of passages of scripture in Revelation and elsewhere where Jesus is viewed as a judge who's going to look unkindly on us. And I'm old enough to remember these tracts, these biblical religious tracts, and I use the word biblical loosely because I... They were a piece of work. They were made by this guy named Chick. We called them Chick tracks. And trust me, there were no pretty girls involved in these tracks. Not that I would ever demean a woman by calling her a chick. Maybe in the 70s, but I got over it quickly. Got to draw a line. So these tracks always had this image of God the Creator, right? And God is going to show in eternity, there's going to be plenty of time, so you can, every moment of our life is going to be put on a big screen for everyone to see, all the embarrassing moments, all the things we said and did that were wrong. And we're supposed to be shamed by all of that and think that God has no room in God's heart for a person like us. It's fear-based thinking, bad theology from the get-go, and yet that's exactly what they're saying when they say, are you preparing to meet Jesus? In other words, have you got a line of logic and attack to defend yourself from God's vengeance and wrath? Be afraid. Be very afraid. But it's not the Jesus we meet in the Gospels. It's not the Jesus I meet. I meet a Jesus who lays a table before sinners and sits and welcomes them. Now, there's a meme that's going around on Facebook. People who they're uncomfortable with the idea that God accepts and loves all people just the way they are. They're uncomfortable with that because they have a hard time loving and accepting all kinds of people for the way they are. They want to be able to judge a little bit. So they say, Jesus invited people to the table, but not out of acceptance and affirmation. He brought them there to witness and change them. And let's be clear. There's something beautiful and transformational about being with Jesus. Remember, Zacchaeus stands up and he says, I've been a crook my whole life. I'm going to fix that. Wonderful transformation. Beautiful. And Jesus has a transforming effect on lots of people. He meets the Samaritan woman at the well, and she becomes transformed. Transformation is part of the experience of knowing Jesus and being with Jesus. But the idea that Jesus sits at table with the sinners, the tax collectors, these folk who he gets a bad reputation for, only to change them, suggests that he doesn't love and accept them, is hurtful. And it doesn't describe people who want to be with Jesus. My feeling is Jesus laid a table and the tax collectors and sinners came because they knew they were welcome, because they knew Jesus was safe. He would hear their stories and he wouldn't judge them. He would show compassion. In fact, that's what it says up there. Come unto me, all ye that labor. Our text said, come to me, you that are weary and are heavy laden. Who among us doesn't feel the weight of the world these days? Is there someone in this room who's not weary? If you're not weary, I would love to know your secret. Because even I've been on vacation at a church meeting for 2 weeks, and I'm worn out, and I haven't had any work. I barely thought of you all. A little bit at the end of the day in my prayers, but you. It was a wedding. I have to tell you, not all of us can dance. So here we have the gospel of Jesus Christ presented to us in Jesus' amazing table fellowship. This amazing love and acceptance that he pours out on people. And someone has tried to twist that and turn that into unacceptance and judgment. And he's only going to love us if we change. Well, that's not what the Bible says. God looked at the world, saw all of its brokenness, all of its sin, all of its pain. God so loved the world. God didn't judge the world. God loved the world. And it even goes on to say in the very next verse that Jesus came not to be a judge, not to condemn, not to be distant and look with eyes of, are you good enough? Are you following the rules? Did you check off all the items on your list? Did you pass your true and false test? Jesus isn't doing any of that. It says Jesus came to save, to heal and to save. Salvation and healing are essentially the same thing in the gospel, because the goal of God is always the shalom of God's people, the well-being of God's people, the wholeness, which is why Jesus is worried about whether we dance and enjoy one another when we're celebrating, and whether we can really own our sadness and when we're face-to-face with injustice and brokenness and violence. Jesus wants us to live fully and completely in God's care. And when we are weary, Jesus says, come to me and I will give you rest. Come to me, you who are weary, and I will give you rest. One of the reasons I need church on Sunday morning, one of the reasons I'm happy to gather with you Sunday after Sunday, isn't that it's just a job. I'm going to acknowledge it is a job. But I love to be in church on Sunday because it's the one place where I know I can be fully the person I am before God and rest. And I pray more than anything that it feels that way to each of you. That you come into this building and you know that no one's going to be judging you or giving you a test, giving you a list of things you have to do, checking your dress code, or when I was in college, testing the length of your hair. Is it over the collar? I actually went to a college that said you can't have your hair over your collar. And I had this one friend who, you know, it was really short in the back, but it just, his collars went down here, so his hair went right there. I don't know where Paul is right now, but I know that he doesn't wear shirts with collars. The love of God is either our central message or we're peddling fear. It's as simple as that. We either believe God loves all the people, the trans people, the black and white and brown and red and yellow and all the people, the LGBTQ folk. God loves all the people, or we should all be very afraid. And frankly, there's no upside to the fear. But at the table of grace, where there is love and acceptance, and we can own our weariness and our sadness and our grief, and we are called from time to time to celebrate and give thanks for new life. These true emotional experiences are included in all of us and for all of us, and that's what the table makes possible. Come to me, all you who are weary, all you are overwhelmed with grief and sadness and sorrow. Those of you who are overcome by the stuff of life, and there's just a lot of stuff. Come to me, and I will give you rest. Don't you just want to exhale? Stop holding your breath. Know that you are a beloved child of God. I hope that you're in that moment now and can feel it. God's goodness, God's grace, because there's always room for you at the table. My friend John Dorhauer, who just finished his 8 years as our General Synod Minister and President, likes to say, the Holy Spirit envisions a world where you matter. I believe that's true. Amen. Friends, our closing hymn is Near to the Heart of God, a beautiful reflection of where I think we're all called to be and live. 472 in your hymnal, all who are comfortably able are invited to stand.
Thank you.
So there's a story, and if I'd looked at my notes once earlier, I would have remembered to tell it earlier. Peter is at the gate of heaven, and Gabriel comes to him and says, "We got a problem." Peter says, "What? What do you mean?" "There's too many people in heaven. There's more people in heaven than have come through the gate." Peter says, "Well, I don't know what to do. I'm just checking people in when they come." And Gabriel says, "I'll go explore." He comes back about 3 hours later and he says, "Never mind, never mind." And Peter says, "Well, why are there so many extra people in heaven?" And Gabriel says, "Well, you know, Jesus has been pulling people in over the back wall." If you're going to take a non-biblical story about Jesus to heart, forget about the one where Jesus is all giving us a test. And let's go with the one where he's pulling us in over the back wall. Go in peace, my friends. Serve the Lord. Love one another. And let us keep the faith. Amen.